Good morning and welcome to Virtual Church here at PCMK. Today is the second Sunday of Advent and it is also the first Sunday of December, so it is a doubly special Sunday. Later this morning at 11 until 12:30, I'll be in the circle in front of the church to offer Holy Communion to you and your family. At the same time, you can drop off items for the giving tree and pick up your treasures from the PCMK Christmas Fair and drop off cookies for the food pantry. It'll be a very festive morning that will get you in the holiday spirit. Our theme today is a promise to a family. Advent is all about a promise fulfilled. It was a promise to ancient Israel, as we saw last week through the prophet Isaiah. And it was a promise to a family, as we will see today. It was a promise to a family long ago, and it is a promise to your family. In this worship video, there is something for the whole family, so we hope you gather together as a family to worship. There's beautiful music of the season, there's a puppet show and song for the children, there's scripture read by Lisa Kitterman Cohen, and we begin with a family lighting the second Advent candle, Joe and Aaron Hayes along with their children, Grant, Camden, and Mackenzie will be in our sanctuary to bring a little light into our darkness. So let us now worship God on the second Sunday of Advent.
A promise to a family. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a child, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and a delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord." The angel went to Mary and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a child, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." These words from the Gospel of Luke tell the story of a promise made to a family. Elizabeth and Mary were cousins, so they were part of an extended family chosen by God to bring hope to the world. Elizabeth's child prepared the way for Mary's child, who is the light of the world. As we light this candle, may we remember the promise made to this one family on behalf of the whole human family. God promises to be with us and to give us hope for the future. That promise is being fulfilled once again this Advent season. Light the candle.
Good morning. Many of you know that my wife Lisa and I sing in chorus chamber voices, and I accompany the group as well. We're fortunate to have some of the finest choral singers in the Westchester area belong to this group. Many of you are also aware during this COVID time that artists are among those who have suffered the most. What we do was meant to be done in community and shared with the community. A few weeks ago, on two consecutive Tuesdays, small groups of chorus came together to join forces in our sanctuary. We wore masks, we socially distanced, and we limited ourselves to 30 minutes. To show our gratitude for being allowed to use the space, we're going to offer this morning a special music from Handel's Messiah, the Christmas portion, and the Glory of the Lord. To begin today's music, we're going to hear a wonderful little and delightful piece composed by Franz Liszt. This is from a piano suite called The Christmas Tree, which he composed in 1875 to 1876. He dedicated this to his granddaughter, Daniela. It's called The Shepherds at the Manger. This is based on a very familiar Christmas tune, and perhaps I can twist Pastor Dale's arm into offering a prize for the person who can identify the tune first. To close today's music, we're going to hear the monumental work by the famous French organist and composer Louis Vierne. This is from his pièce de fantaisie, his fantasy pieces, the third book, the closing movement, Caroline de Westminster. This piece is based entirely on the very familiar Westminster chime, which I'm sure many of you know, especially if you've had a grandfather or grandmother's clock in your family. Finally, the hymn I chose to go with today's text and message, number 16, The Angel Gabriel from Heaven Came, to the tune Gabriel's Message. I hope this music adds some excitement to the very quickly approaching Christmas holiday. This is the day the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Good morning. Welcome back. This is Mishmash, your favorite Sunday school substitute teacher. Okay, so have you ever been outside in the middle of nowhere and seen all the stars? How many stars do you think there are? Has anyone ever tried to count them all? Today we are going to hear something that God once said about all those stars and how many of them there are. This morning we're going to look at the promise of a baby and how the fulfillment of this promise was a huge part of God's rescue plan. Now, I know what you're thinking. We all know a baby was a huge part of the rescue plan. Jesus came to earth as a baby. And if that was what you were thinking, then you would be right, but not about this story. Today's story is about God promising an old man that he would be the father of a nation. You've probably figured it out by now, but this man was Abraham. He was 90 years old and his wife Sarah was 80. God has asked Abraham to follow him to a new place and had promised Abraham that he would be the father of a great nation. Now, God isn't just saying that Sarah will have a baby, but she'll be the mother of nations and kings. As we continue through this month, we'll see that great kings like David came from Abraham and Sarah's family line. And even greater than that, Jesus himself, the forever king, came from their family line. In the next few weeks, we're going to continue talking about why Jesus came to earth. But for now, let's remember to thank God for the promise he made to Abraham, the promised baby. See you guys next week.
Today's sermon is about having hope. And one of the reasons Jesus came was to give us hope. So we have two verses for our Advent song. He came down. He came down that we may have light. And this week, he came down that we may have hope. So learn it as we sing it. He came down that we may have light. He came down. Hope alive in your heart all week. We miss you and love you and hope you have a great week. Until next time.
Good morning, everybody. Today's reading is from the book of Luke, chapter 1, verses 67 through 80, the New Revised Standard Version. This reading is known as Zechariah's prophecy. Then his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke this prophecy. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has looked favorably on his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a mighty Savior for us in the house of his servant David. He spoke through the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we would be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us. Thus he has shown the mercy promised to our ancestors and has remembered his holy covenant. The oath that he swore to our ancestor Abraham, to grant us that we, being rescued from the hands of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness, before him all of our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the forgiveness of our sins. By the tender mercy of our God, the dawn from on high will break upon us to give light to those who sit in darkness and the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. The child grew and became strong in spirit, and he was in the wilderness until the day he appeared publicly to Israel. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
But you promised. Those words meant you were in trouble in my family growing up. If you said you would do something, that's one thing. But if you promised, you had better do it. To break a promise was to commit a mortal sin. It was a bold-faced lie to promise something and not follow through. Apparently, I had promised my little sister that I would take her to the mountains to go skiing one winter. I don't remember when I made the promise, but I remember her torturing me with those words, "But you promised." So late that winter, I drove her 5 hours to Jasper for a day of skiing in the Canadian Rockies. Actually, I didn't mind a day of skiing, but I'll never forget the way she was going to hold me to that promise, no matter what. There was no way it was not going to happen once she had heard me say the magic words, "I promise, I'll take you." Our theme for Advent this year is A Promise Fulfilled. Last week, the first Sunday of Advent, we looked at the promise made to ancient Israel with the words from Isaiah, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given." This week, our focus is on a promise to a family. Actually, we're going to look at the promises the angel Gabriel made to two families. But the women in this story are cousins, so they are part of one extended family. We all know the story of what we sometimes call the Holy Family. The angel Gabriel visited a young woman named Mary and made her a promise. It was a promise that she would have a child, a very special child. She found it hard to believe, but she accepted the promise of the angel that nothing was impossible with God. She received the promise with the words the Beatles made famous, "Let it be." We all know that story quite well. We remember that promise that was fulfilled in the babe born in a manger. Less well known is the promise that was made earlier to Mary's cousin Elizabeth. Now, I wonder if they were not second cousins or something, because they were of totally different generations. Elizabeth was very old and Mary was very young. But the Gospel of Luke tells us they were cousins, they were family, and they were both going to have a baby. They were both going to have miracle babies. They were both going to have promises fulfilled. Before Gabriel appeared to Mary, he made a visit to Zechariah, a priest who was the husband of Elizabeth. Zechariah had gone into the temple to burn incense at the altar when Gabriel showed up with this message for a frightened old man. "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He will prepare the way for the Lord." Zechariah found it hard to believe. He asked how this could possibly be true, because he and Elizabeth were both very old. Gabriel was not happy that Zechariah did not believe him, and he was in trouble. But for the opposite reason that I got in trouble with my sister. I was in trouble for not keeping a promise. Zechariah was in trouble for not believing a promise. It was like he was saying God was not going to keep that promise. It was just too hard. How could he? But Gabriel made it clear that God's promises are always fulfilled. The punishment he received was appropriate. He had shot off his mouth at the angel. So he was made mute. He was unable to speak until the child was born, which, according to Elizabeth, was a mixed blessing. When the child was finally born, Zechariah broke into song. It would make a great Broadway musical, wouldn't it, for Zechariah to sing because he was so happy that his promise had been fulfilled. A promise for his family, a promise for all families, because his child would prepare the way of the Lord. His son would guide our feet into the path of peace, not just for his family, but for all people. If you are a fan of good literature, you'll love the use of allusion and parallelism in the story of these promises fulfilled. The promise to aging Zechariah and Elizabeth is an allusion to the Old Testament promise to Abraham and Sarah. who were also very old when they had their miracle child, Isaac. It is a reminder that God works in and through families. God's promises are fulfilled from one generation to the next. There's also a nice parallelism in the last verse of these first two chapters of the Gospel of Luke. Chapter 1 ends with these words, "And the child grew and became strong in spirit, and he lived in the wilderness until he appeared publicly to Israel." The second chapter ends with, "And the child grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and others." The first chapter describes the growth of John the Baptist, while chapter 2 uses similar words to describe the growth of his cousin Jesus. A nice literary tool to connect these two families together even more. It's nice to think of John and Jesus growing up in families, isn't it? It's nice to know they were looked forward to and wanted and treasured by their parents. It's nice to know that they had extended family that loved them and watched them grow with pride. Every child should be wanted. Every child should have a family. Family has always been important, but this year of the pandemic has made us realize just how important family is. We've spent a lot of time together in families, but we've also learned how much we treasure extended family, like grandparents and even maybe great-grandparents. We took for granted the opportunity to go see them whenever we wanted, or to go pick them up for Thanksgiving or Christmas. Our oldest family members have been most at risk during this crisis, so we've had to keep a distance. They've been lonely, and many have even died alone. Families should be together for all life's moments, for birthdays and weddings, for graduations and celebrations. We should certainly be together at the time of death, and at least for a memorial to celebrate the life well lived. Families make promises, but even more than that, family is a promise. Families are a promise that there will be a future. The next generation will come and will carry forward the hopes and dreams and traditions of the family. Children fulfill the promise that life will go on, that there is always hope for the future. Advent is a reminder that there is hope because of promises made to those families long ago. There is hope because the same God who made those promises has promised to be with us and with our families. When we baptize a child, we quote this verse from Acts chapter 2. "For the promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls." Baptism is a promise to a family that they are now part of God's family. The family bringing forth the child is surrounded by extended family and a church family to claim the promises of God for the child and for the future of that family, the church family, and yes, the human family. We've heard promises in the news lately that there is good news coming for every family. We have heard that vaccines are on the way. That is the promise of science, but it is also the promise of God. It is God's world, and God has given us the resources of the mind to discover cures for diseases and vaccines to stop the spread of diseases. That promise is going to be felt in the economy, in cities, and most of all, in families. We will be able to be with all our loved ones to celebrate life's moments, to remember the past, and to hope for the future. Later today, we will remember another promise that God has made to us. The Lord's Supper is many things to us. Communion is a moment of deeply personal devotion, but it is also a special time for the family and even the church family to be together. Today we are doing communion a little differently. We are doing it safely, of course, but it is still a time for families. Many families will come in the car together, while others will take the little bread and cup home to their family so they can celebrate together. The promise of communion is the ultimate one. It is the promise of Christ coming again. We end the words of institution with the promise in these familiar words: as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. That promise is Christ's Advent. He came once long ago. That is what Advent is all about. But he is coming again. Christ will come to be with us whenever we need his love and his presence. And we believe Christ will come again someday. We don't know how or when, but he has promised to come again. That is a promise you can count on. It is a promise that the future, no matter how bleak it looks now, is ultimately in God's hands. And God has not given up on us or on our future. Have you had someone break a promise to you? It's disappointing, isn't it? But we're only human. We make promises and we sometimes break them. But God never breaks a promise. God has promised a future full of hope. Let us stand on that promise as we move through Advent and Christmas and into this new year. And so when we get to the end of next year, we can look back and say to God, you promised. And it will have been a promise fulfilled to you and to your family. Amen. Would you pray with me, please? Gracious God, we thank you for your promise made to those families long ago. We thank you that your promise of Emmanuel, God with us, came through a family to remind us that we are all part of your family. We pray for the families in our church who are struggling through the challenges of this pandemic. We pray for those who face financial hardship and for those who have an aging family member they cannot be with. We thank you for the progress that has been made on vaccines that will bring this disease to an end. Help us to not lose hope in the difficult days ahead. Help us to remember and trust your promise to give us a future and a hope. We pray all this in the name of the one who is our hope, the one who is your promise fulfilled, even our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, God bless you. Hope to see you a little later this morning in the circle for Holy Communion, and then come by for the Christmas fair and the giving tree and bring some package of cookies if you can. It'll be good to see you. It'll be good to be together as a family. God bless and see you soon.